1930s, England was on the side of Nazi Germany. England kept appeasing Nazi Germany regularly throughout the 1930s up to 1938, when England and France gave Germany Czechoslovakia. And it's more likely in some ways that things would have continued like that, to keep going the way that they had been going, than that they would change and that Britain would defy Germany and have a war. Because if we weren't going to fight over Czechoslovakia, why would we fight over Poland? Poland was no more important than Czechoslovakia to British interests. And Churchill did want to fight and very much insisted on keeping up the fight. And once the war had begun in 1939 and then on into 1940, and Hitler was doing so well, then after the fall of France in May of 1940, there was no way that England could possibly win the Second World War from that point on their own. There was absolutely no way. They had no allies. They had no bases on the continent. They had the RAF, but the RAF were fighting the Battle of Britain. France was lost. It would have been very easy for any sensible person to decide to accept Hitler's offer of a truce. And Hitler offered three times, once directly, once through the Pope, and once through Sweden. And it was basically, let's call it a draw, okay? It was, we're all friends here, let's call it a draw. We'll all keep what we've got, and we'll go home, and that'll be the end of it. And really, if the policies of the 1930s had continued, it's perfectly reasonable that somebody would have accepted that. It's more likely than what did happen, where Churchill decided that England would fight on when it wasn't possible to win. Now, he was counting on the idea that the Americans would come and join in and save us and you and everybody, as indeed happened. But the US didn't come into the war until December of 1941. That is, from May of 1940 to December of 1941 is almost 2 years in which Hitler just bombed the heck out of Britain, and Britain had no way to retaliate. They were fighting in North Africa, but there was no way from North Africa that you could win a war with Germany. There's just no tactical way that it makes any sense. So in the small change universe, in the universe of these novels, the peace is made in May of 1941. So Britain fights on for one more year after the fall of France. The Blitz happens. And at the point where in real life, Hitler turned and started to attack the Soviets, so he broke the treaty. In reality, he sent a fourth attempt to make peace to Britain. Hess flew to Britain, the Hess mission, and to make the same peace offer of let's call it a draw. And in reality, Hess was captured and imprisoned, and he stayed imprisoned until he died in prison in the 1970s. But in my world, Hess got to some of the people who were, okay, yeah, we've had enough now, there's no way we can win, who were the same people who all through the 1930s had been right there saying that nice Mr. Hitler, and they made the farthing peace in that universe. And so the situation in 1949 in Farthing and Halfpenny, and then in 1960 in Half a Crown, is that the Third Reich have everything up to the channel. They have what they had as of 1941, and then in Eastern Europe in 1949, they're still fighting the Soviets. By 1960, they've defeated the Soviets because they have the atomic bomb. and they've used nukes on the Russians, and the Russians are now out of it. And China is being divided between the Japanese co-prosperity sphere and the Third Reich. And they're building a buffer zone, and that's happening. And there is a big peace conference happening in London, which is going to sort all that out. When you're working with real history, you're always projecting everything forward, and you have to look at all of the trends. And you look at where things were and take them forward, either in the same way or in a different way. So some things would have continued in the same way and some things would have happened very differently. So, for instance, television was invented just before the Second World War, and then it was turned off for the duration in the UK. So the television was stopped, and it didn't start again until after the war, when it started up again, and it didn't become big until the 50s. But in that world, they had the war and it was turned off, and then they started it up again. So television is big earlier. But I was thinking about, for instance, the motorway system, because the motorways were not built in reality until the 1950s. But they would probably have happened earlier with a shorter war. But the word motorway is a modern word that came into use only in the 50s. So I thought, in that world, where they were copying the German autobahns, and as far as the social consequences go, the real social consequence of the Second World War was the dismantling of the class system, which, of course, did not happen in that universe. So I looked at the trends of the 30s and thought, well, if this continued. And I'd read a lot of fiction that was set in the 40s and 50s, British fiction, which was written inherently by educated people who were middle-class people. And very often there is a tone of lamenting the lost good days when it was easy to get servants. And, of course, when you think about this from our point of view, that wouldn't have been such good days, because we would have been the servants and it would have been horrible. But for the point of view of Evelyn Waugh and Neville Shute and writers like that, yeah, their mothers can't go to the south of France anymore and they can't get servants. So I thought, in that world where the war went so differently, you'd be easy to get servants. That would be great. You'd be very, very easy. You could get servants if you were the rich people. And you could go to the south of France, because you wouldn't mind that Hitler was in charge. That would be okay. It's, you know, Pétainist France would still be there, and you could go to the south of France, and you wouldn't care about the trains taking people off to concentration camps. Why would you care about that? You hate the Jews anyway, because that's what people were like. Things socially just carried on this repulsive way that things were in the 1930s. And so I just extended those bad things out. And if you read Dorothy Sayers and Agatha Christie and things that were written in the 30s, you find Josephine Thayer, I love Josephine Thayer, but she's got this amazing anti-Semitism, and it'll just be there, and it makes you really blink when you read that now. But that's how people thought at that time. If all three books have a different first-person female narrator, and then third-person chapters from the point of view of the detective Carmichael. And the first-person narrator in Half a Crown, Elvira Royston, is a girl whose father is Sergeant Royston, who appears in the earlier books, and she's been brought up by Carmichael, she's been sent to good schools, she's had an education, and she's going to come out as a debutante. And she is 18, 19, and her entire life has been lived in this world where the farthing piece is what you have. And she's never known anything before this terrible world. So in the first chapter, I have her saying, fascism is such fun. And every time I read that chapter, my audience would gasp. They would literally draw in their breath and gasp, because it's really quite horrifying. And so I feel that the third book is in many ways a dystopia. And it really is. It really is a very unpleasant place to live. And it makes you realise how much nicer the real world is, even with all its imperfections.